Welcome, Anna.
This is Anna Spekianaki, and the work I'm going to present to you today was conducted at the University of Crete in cooperation with George Kafantzis. The current study investigates voice quality characteristics of Greek adults with normal hearing and hearing loss, automatically obtained from glottal inverse filtering or GIF analysis using the AltoApparat toolkit developed at Aalto University. AltoApparat offers state-of-the-art QCP analysis. It is user-friendly and has been employed in glottal flow analysis of disordered speech, but to the best of our knowledge, not as yet in hearing-impaired voice analysis and assessment. Hearing loss, especially when occurring prelingually, compromises various aspects of normal speech production, affecting deviant articulatory configuration, but also problematic control of respiration and phonation. Inappropriate management of glottal airflow, vocal fold abduction and adduction gestures, vocal fold tension and mass, velopharyngeal movement leads to severe difficulties in articulation and prosody in hearing impaired speech. Hence, hearing impaired voice quality has been reported as breathy, tense, harsh, throaty, or flat, while among common hearing impaired voice problems are inappropriate pitch and loudness, strain, roughness, and vocal fatigue. Why study the vocal function of speakers with hearing impairment? The assessment of glottal aerodynamics can provide useful information about vocal fold movement and glottal airflow during speech. Thus, we can obtain suitable measures for examination of differences in vocal adjustments of speakers with hearing impairment, as well as suitable measures for the detection of hearing impaired voice deviations. Vocal function can be examined using various instrumental methods. Electrolaryngography or electroglottography is a non-invasive technique commonly used for vocal fold vibration monitoring and voice quality assessment. Another instrumental technique involves the Rothenberg mask, which utilizes inverse filtering of the oral flow signal. It has been used in combination with the electroglottograph to describe the vocal functioning of deaf speakers. Vocal fold movement can also be observed via laryngeal endoscopic imaging, such as video endoscopy and video stroboscopy. These methods involve the insertion of a long tube in the speaker's throat in order to visualize vocal fold activity. Although instrumental methods are recommended for the assessment of the vibratory function of the vocal folds during phonation, they can be expensive and/or invasive, and the use of some of them in clinical practice has been characterized as highly subjective. Alternatively, measurements directly from the glottal airflow velocity signal or recorded speech can be made using GIF. Glottal inverse filtering, or GIF, is heavily based on the source filter paradigm introduced by Funt, where speech can be considered as the outcome of a linear filtering operation, with the source signal being the glottal excitation signal and the filter being the vocal tract. GIF introduces the idea of inversion, according to which the effects of vocal tract and lip radiation are cancelled from the speech signal. Thus, by analyzing the speech signal, we can estimate the glottal excitation. The usefulness of GIF in pathological speech analysis has been demonstrated in the literature. However, GIF analysis is not a trivial task to perform from scratch, and it is not included in most commercial or freely available speech analysis software for immediate assessment of voice quality. For the current investigation, the participants were 10 Greek adult speakers, 5 with normal hearing and 5 with prelingual profound hearing impairment, balanced for gender. All participants were 18 to 35 years old and native speakers of Greek. Hearing loss was diagnosed before the age of 2. They had all been fitted with hearing aids by the age of 3 and had received more than 4 years of speech therapy at the time of the recording. They produced symmetrical CBCVD syllables with the consonant P and the corner vowels E, A, U with stress on the first syllable in a carrier phrase, Lege pali, say again. Each syllable was produced 10 times in a soundproof room used for audiological evaluations. Participants were asked to read the sentences at a comfortable rate and volume. A total number of 300 items was analyzed. Was a closed phase or QCP analysis was employed for voice source estimation as provided by AltoApparat. QCP is a method inspired from closed phase analysis, that is, the estimation of the vocal tract during the closed phase of the glottis. Compared to closed phase based methods, the proposed technique does not utilize the covariance method of linear prediction to estimate the vocal tract filter, but takes advantage of weighted linear prediction in order to exploit all the examples of an analysis frame of successive pitch periods, emphasizing on the samples which are located in the closed phase. The analysis was conducted on 6 glottal cycles of the stressed per syllable vowel of every repetition, hence 1,800 measurements were conducted in total. Although the analysis was automatic, all cycles were manually selected so as to avoid problematic cases, for example, uneven, incomplete, or altogether missing cycles, which sometimes occurred mainly for speakers with hearing impairment. This is a screenshot from Apparat, and the figure on the right shows 6 cycles of a normal hearing speaker, which is a straightforward case. In the upper panel is a recorded speech signal, and in the lower panel, the estimated glottal source signal. Here on the left, there's an example of a speaker with normal hearing, and on the right of a speaker with hearing impairment, both good examples. This slide shows problematic cases of 2 hearing impaired speakers as the cycles are uneven or incomplete. So the analysis had to be based further into the signal. After voice loss estimation using QCP, we extracted 3 domain parameters and 4 frequency domain parameters. Time domain parameters included the normalized amplitude quotient, NAC, which describes the glottal closing phase and discriminates between different phonation types. The closing quotient, CQ, which measures the ratio of the duration of the closing phase to the glottal cycle and reflects the abruptness of vocal full closure, and the quasi-open quotient, QQ, which is defined as the ratio of the quasi-open time or the quasi-closed time of the glottis, normalized with respect to the period of the waveform. Although the time-based parameters, open quotient and speed quotient, were calculated as well, they were excluded from the statistical analysis, as the majority of the automatically obtained values were erroneous. In order to receive accurate OQ and SQ result, it seems a great deal of fine-tuning of the GIF settings is required. The frequency domain parameters included the harmonic richness factor, HRF, which quantifies the amount of harmonics in the spectrum of the glottal source signal, and its usefulness in voice quality characterization has been demonstrated in the literature. H1 minus H2, which is defined as the difference between the fundamental frequency log amplitude and the log amplitude of the second harmonic of the glottal source. It is considered to be a rough measure of spectral decay. The parabolic spectral parameter, PSP, which fits a second order polynomial to the glottal source log spectrum over a single glottal cycle and has been associated with phonation type. And finally, F0 information. A review illustrating the capability of all these glottal source parameters in discriminating different voice qualities can be found in ALCO 2011. Statistical analyses of variance were run for the 3 time-based parameters and the 4 frequency-based parameters of the vowels E, A, U versus the factors gender and hearing status. 2 Kiposchop tests were also run between the 2 genders within hearing group. The results showed that gender was significant for a lot of parameters, hence comparisons between speakers with normal hearing versus hearing impairment were subsequently conducted separately for each gender. Hearing status was not found statistically significant for the F0 parameter, but it was found significant for most of the other parameters. F0 in hearing impaired speech was reported deviant in some studies and within normal range in others. Instead of F0 mean values, F0 variance or other measures might be more promising as features. Looking at the male speakers now, regarding the time domain, significant differences were located between speakers with normal hearing and hearing impairment in all 3 parameters. CQ was found lower, denoting more abrupt vocal full closure than normal. It could also indicate higher intensity and or more pressed phonation than normal. QEQ was found significantly lower in vowels A and E, indicating more tense voice for male speakers with hearing impairment. Frequency domain measures reflect changes in phonation type and vocal quality of the speaker. H1, H2 is a rough measure of spectral decay, as mentioned earlier. High values denote steeper decay towards breathy phonation, whereas low values indicate gradual decay towards pressed phonation. In our data, male speakers with hearing impairment display significantly lower H1, H2 values for vowels A and U than normal. HRF depicts the amplitude relationships of higher harmonics to the F0 amplitude. This parameter was found higher than normal only in vowel O, again suggesting steeper decay and subsequently more pressed phonation. PSP has been associated with phonation type. Lower values indicate pressed phonation, while higher values breathy phonation. Variable results were found depending on the vowel. Regarding female speakers, time-based parameters present more differences than frequency-based parameters, and differential trends from male hearing-impaired speakers were located. In vowels A and E, all time-based parameters were found higher than normal, which may indicate that female speakers with hearing impairment assume a more gradual vocal foreclosure and breathy voice. However, opposite trends were observed for vowel U. Regarding frequency-based parameters, no significant differences were located in H1, H2, or HRF for any vowel. PSP values were higher for vowels A and U, reaching statistical significance only for A, again denoting more breathy phonation. This shows the overall picture for the two genders. For male hearing impaired speakers, significantly lower values in time domain parameters, as well as lower H1, H2, and higher HRF were found, indicating more abrupt vocal foreclosure, higher intensity, and more pressed phonation. While for female speakers with hearing impairment, significantly higher values than normal in time domain parameters and higher PSP were located, suggesting more gradual vocal foreclosure and breathier voice. In conclusion, significant differences in a number of glottal source characteristics, as investigated via time and frequency-based parameters provided by Alto apparat, have been located in hearing impaired versus normal hearing speech, suggesting differential laryngeal adjustment than normal for hearing impaired speakers, in agreement with previous literature. Results in most parameters indicate more breathy voice for female speakers with hearing impairment and more pressed phonation than normal for male speakers with hearing impairment, which could also be associated with problematic placement of stress and intensity control. Among the three corner vowels, E, A, and O, most differences in glottal source parameters between speakers with hearing impairment and normal hearing were located in vowel O. This is an interesting observation, as vowel U is a high-back vowel that has been found significantly fronted for Greek speakers with hearing impairment. Therefore, the existence of both deviant articulation and phonation in this vowel suggests a link between articulatory configuration and phonation in hearing impaired speech. Gender differences in the hearing impaired group may be related to differences in intelligibility level and individual strategies. Individual variability is evident in most parameters. Hence, this factor will be involved in the next step of our investigation. Besides looking at the individual strategies and analyzing larger data sets, which was a limitation of this study, future work could also include time-varying GIF, as well as DNN-based strategies for increased robustness and accuracy of the results. In addition, association of time and frequency-based parameters with hearing impaired voice quality ratings by speech pathologists would help identify which GIF parameters significantly correlate with specific perceptual attributes. Sustained phonation data could be analyzed and compared with analysis from the syllables including fricative consonants, as interarticulatory timing has been found deviant in hearing impaired speech. We expect that an investigation of voice features involving production of different voiceless consonants may present great interest. GIF has been documented as a useful method in atypical voice analysis. However, there is still paucity of research on disordered voices as compared to healthy voices, and more research is needed specifically on the voice characteristics of speakers with hearing impairment, either using hearing aids or cochlear implants, as the influence of hearing loss on many aspects of voice and speech is yet to be defined. Thank you for your attention.